not, I mean, they was talking about modesty, but you can have a dress on down to your past your knees or to your ankle, and you're still modest. But they took that to the extreme and took that out of context as far as I'm concerned, because God didn't condemn me no more, and I'm let that go. But it's not seen to me anymore. But if you feel condemned, then don't wear them slacks.
All right, missionary. All right, don't wear them slacks. Let the legs let get cold. All right. Well, you know, a lot of things that people operated in were not scripturally based. So that's the reason why it's so important to get knowledge. Okay, I wanted to read this. I think I overlooked it. Hebrews 11:25. Choosing rather, this was the thing that Moses did. This was his disposition. This is the thing that made him so great. He chose rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pledges of sin for a what? Season. And that's a good lesson for us. That's the reason why we can't get caught up in the things of this world, because these things are just for a what?
Season.
So you'd be better off to what? Suffer affliction for the sake of the gospel. Amen. Esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt, for he had respect unto the recompense of the reward. He knew that at the end of all of his what? Mission and the work that God had called him to do, amen, that was going to be a reward. And that's what we're going to talk about in a few minutes. There are going to be some rewards. That's the reason why we want to take our commitment very, very serious, because we're going to have to give an account of our lives. We're going to have to give an account. And I began last week to tell you the things that you're going to be judged on, and you will have to give an account of how you went about, amen, carrying out the commission that God has placed in your life. All right, verse 27, by faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing to him who is invisible. All right, now all of the lesson you should have gone through, and we see here that Moses trusted God wholeheartedly. Point one, point two under B, Moses trusted God wholeheartedly. And at the top of page 20, he says, and there arose not a prophet since in Israel like unto Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face. So Moses was a prophet. God knew him what? Face to face. How many of us can say God knows us face to face? Amen. In other words, God talks directly to us. Most of us, you know, we hear from God through his word. Amen. But God talked face to face with Moses. In all of the signs and wonders which the Lord sent him to do in the land of Egypt to Pharaoh and to all of his servants and to all of his land. And in all of that mighty hand, and in all of the great terror which God showed in the sight of all Israel. Right. Which Moses showed in the sight of all Israel. You won't hardly find anybody in the Old Testament that had such an anointed and powerful life. With all of the signs and wonders and all of the prophecies and how God led him. It's just amazing how God led him. Now let's just read down. Moses is an excellent example of a faithful ambassador who speaks on the behalf and promotes the interests of the one he represents. He is described as the servant of the Lord. How many times?
18.
Being God's prophet and representative, he spoke and performed what the Lord instructed and commanded him. After leaving Egypt and throughout the wilderness journey, he trusted God and him alone for instructions. Now just watch that. For instructions. What kind of instructions? You'll see down here later on. Directions, provisions, and protection. He didn't have any of that in place. God had to instruct him as to what to do, what direction, how, when, what. God had to give him directions as to what path to take, how to escape the wrath of all of those that were coming against him, provisions, They had no food, water. God had to what? He provide water and their entire livelihood and protection. As a result, God in his manifold mercies forsook them not in the wilderness. Amen. That's very powerful. God in his manifold what? Mercies forsook them not in the wilderness. So God is full of mercy. The pillar of cloud departed not from them by day to lead them in the way, neither the pillar of fire by night to show them light and the way wherein they should go. See, God was actually directing every step. God's good spirit was given them to instruct them, and he did not withhold manna from their mouth and gave them water for their thirst. For 40 years this the Lord sustained them in the wilderness so that they lacked nothing. Their clothes waxed not old, and their feet swell not. Amen. That's something. Moses' prayer for God to show him his way is a classic example of his dependence upon the Lord in Exodus 33, 13 through 17. Verse 13, this is a very classic scripture. I pray thee, if I have found grace in thy sight, show me now thy way, that I may know thee, that I may find grace in thy sight, and consider that this nation is thy people. And he said, my presence shall go with thee, and I will give thee rest. That's God's response. Moses wanted to find grace. He wanted to know that he was operating in the grace of God, the favor of God. And he wanted to know for sure that God was going to stand with him as he lead the children of Israel to the land that was promised to them. God said, my presence shall go with thee. Ooh, isn't that powerful? My presence shall go. How many ever heard that in the late night season? My presence shall go with thee. Nobody heard that. Amen. And I will give thee rest. Amen. I will give thee rest. That's what God is saying even today. My presence shall go with thee, and I will give thee rest. And he said unto him, if thy presence go not with me, carry us not hence. Amen. So Moses didn't want to face all that he was about to face unless he was absolutely sure that God's presence will what? Accompany him. Amen. You know, sometimes we just walk on out there. We don't care whether God's, we don't even ask for God's presence. The scripture says, in all of our ways, what? Acknowledge him. Morning, amen, sometimes we don't have time to acknowledge him. Nothing. Amen. We just get up, what? Running. Just like a chicken with his head cut off. It's flopping here, flopping there. We ain't asked God for no direction, no instruction. We feel like we're on our own. God just let you what? Go on and just what make a mess of ourselves. All right. For wherein shall it be known here that I and thy people have found grace in thy sight? God, amen. Moses said, how can we know for sure that we have found favor in your sight? Is it not in that thou goest with us? So shall we be separated, I and thy people, from all thy people that are upon the face of the earth. So Moses was smart enough to know. He said, if you don't go with us, amen, there's no way that we can what, face the future and we can succeed in, amen, coming to the place where you have decreed that we will eventually find rest. Amen. And the Lord said unto Moses, I will do this thing also that thou hast spoken. For thou hast found grace in my sight, and I know thee by name. Why do you think that Moses had that much clout with God? God said to him, I will do this thing also that thou hast spoken, for thou hast found grace. Why do you think Moses found so much grace in God's sight? All right. All right, okay, come on, come on, come on. Why did Moses find that quality of favor from
his
God?
Humility.
All right, so the brother Wendell hit it right on the head. One of the main ways that you can always get God to release his grace in your life is through humility. Amen. The scripture says, God resists the proud, and he gives what?
Grace to the
humble. And that is the reason why many times we ask members to fast and pray, because that has a good way to get you out of your fleshly, what? Ram, and get you back to what? Your sincere devotion to God. Amen. Your soul is humble. Sometimes we get to the point where we feel like we can operate without giving God the glory that's due him, without giving our due reverence, you know, to the Lord. Amen. So fasting can get you back to a point where you can kind of see what's going on. And you can see how far off you are, what? Traveling. And then it'll bring you back to your sincere devotion. Now, you have to admit that there has to be a humbling element, component in fasting, because every great man of God practiced it. Moses went up on the mountain. Even before he got the Ten Commandments, he went up there, what? Twice for 40 days fasting. Before he could come back with the Ten Commandments, see, God had to speak very clear and distinct. I mean, he took being very attentive during that period of time in order to get the quality of message that Moses got back when he brought that tablet down from the mountain. All of these laws and statutes, you read in these five books of Moses, the first five books of the Bible, that was as a result of Moses being what? In tune with God. He was able to what? Hear the voice of God. So a person in the flesh is not going to be what? They're going to be very impatient. They're going to be here and there. They're not going to settle down. They're not going to be what? In a position to really discern what God is actually saying. So that's the reason why it's important for God's people to stop sometimes and let your flesh what? Diminish and get back in tune so God can really speak to you heart to heart. Get back to your pure and sincere devotion to God. That's one, sincerity. All right. And obedience is another, right? Amen. Obedience is another thing that caused God's grace to be released into your life. Faith is another, amen, ingredient or component. And the scripture says that we enter into, by grace, we have access into his grace through faith. That's right. That's Romans 5, 1, 2, I believe. We have access into his grace by faith. So faith is a big component. And another scripture says, grace and peace be multiplied through the knowledge. So there are a lot of things that we can do to get God's grace released into his life. And Moses employed some of those disciplines and virtues that enable God to release the grace that he needed in order for him to be sustained, to be blessed, and to be led of the Holy Spirit, and to be successful in all that he set out to do. Those virtues Moses submitted to. He developed those things, and they came through walking with God, listening to God, and submitting to God. All right, now I like this part here better, amen. I really like, I like his faithfulness in all of his house. All right, Moses, this is his faithfulness in all of God's house. Moses received the law, valuable statutes, God's covenant for Israel. He was given detail and careful instructions for the holy erection of the tabernacle and operation of the priesthood. Can you fathom how detailed Moses was able to receive those particular instructions? How to erect the tabernacle? How many know, if you read what book of the Bible it deals with the tabernacle, how he did all of these things. It must have been numbers or numbers. And all of these intricate instructions, I mean, this got to be 8 by 12 feet, 6.5 inches, and I mean, it's a whole bunch of stuff. Somebody said that the instructions, even for the priest had to remember to do 600, over 600 things, details. Over 600 specific things the priest had to do. All right, and for the operation of an efficient system of government, details concerning various sacrifices, laws for holy living. And God knows how long those books are that spells out Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. Boy, that stuff is so long and drawn out in detail. But God gave him all of those details. How many of us would have had patience? Y'all raise your hand,
Right
back. Y'all, while I go, I said a 3-hour prayer meeting. Some of y'all are running for that. Y'all won't show up for no 3-hour prayer meeting if you can help it. Like, hallelujah. All right, but Moses, he was cut from a different stock. Laws for holy living, the observance of feasts, were also, God knows how many feasts they had, but they had specific instructions, and those that read the Bible through, you can appreciate, amen, how God worked so marvelous through Moses. The observance of feasts were also set forth through Moses to set them apart as a holy nation, separate unto the Lord. All of these things were done so Israel could become a holy nation. A nation separated unto God. In other words, holiness means to be set apart for God's, what, for God's service, God's will, to be set apart. It doesn't always mean, there's one definition which we call holiness, a process in which we separate ourselves from all moral evil, and even from our flesh. That is the deeper meaning of holiness. But holiness, when it comes to just the word holiness, to mean means to set apart, for God's use. So Moses, the children of Israel were a people that were set aside to carry out God's will and God's plan for the human race. Okay.
Is there a difference in holiness then and sanctification?
Sanctification and holiness are synonymous words. And when we say sanctification and holiness, you know, you're talking about it now, but the deeper meaning would be separation. And it goes down, separation from the ungodly, evil influences, from ungodly people, ungodly teachers, and even separation from the works of your flesh. In other words, the works of your flesh is the most critical aspect of sanctification. That's the part that many times we, you know, sometimes we stay away from the clubs and the discos and the this and that and moral evil, but many times when it comes to our ways and habits and dispositions and things that displease God, sometimes we never separate ourselves from them. One of them is that separation from our flesh is that when people, to give you a good illustration that we're trying to, something we're trying to accomplish, we're trying to get people to praise the Lord with all of their heart, because the scripture in Philippians 3:3 says, we worship the Lord, we the circumcision. Everybody says circumcision. These are people that are sanctified. We worship the Lord in spirit. We what? Rejoice in Jesus Christ. We have no confidence in the flesh. See, we're supposed to be filled with the Holy Spirit. That's the only way we can carry out God's will. That's the only way we can impact people. Get people saved. People believe us. People will establish credibility. People will desire what you have. You have to be filled with the Holy Ghost. You can't be half-baked and half, you know, half-hearted. And, oh, gosh. Oh, God. I wish
I wish some of us could go back to the time when people were really, really real. I wasn't part of that years ago, but Marvin's come a long ways. Oh, come a long ways. I remember sanctified folk used to dance for 15 and 20 and 30 minutes straight. Some of them were real. You know, we had some showboats. In the early days, people were really genuine. Recently, people have all these showboats, people have these sophisticated dances. Everybody just be watching the show. Boy, they got some moves and turns and jumps and jerks. Boy, they can entertain anybody. But I don't consider that as really being of the spirit of life. All right, let's move forward. All the things that God commanded Moses to do were carefully performed. His obedience and submission to the Lord was unquestionable. The phrase, just as the Lord had commanded Moses, pertaining to his diligence and strict adherence in following, watch this, every detailed instruction given by the Lord. It appears at least 17 times in Exodus chapters 39 and 40. Now, all of these details and laws and statutes and all of these things that Moses had to institute and carry out, the scripture says 17 times in two chapters, the word just as the Lord had commanded Moses. Suppose all of us could worship the Lord just as the Lord has commanded his people. That would just be one. And Moses had, seemed like it was zillions of things that Moses had to what? Be responsible for, carry out. So you can see why he became such a commanding figure and such a dominant figure in the Old Testament. And you can see why he was the mediator of the Old Covenant. He was a great man. Every time a prophet talked after Moses, they referred back to who? Moses. Even on the Mount of Transfiguration, who appeared with Jesus? Moses and Elijah. Who did Jesus refer to in his teaching a whole lot? He referred back to who? Moses. So you won't find a more commanding figure in the Old Testament than Moses because of this particular reason, just as the Lord had commanded him. And we take the commands and the things that God demands of us and commands of us, we take it so lightly, haphazardly. Amen. That's the reason why we need a Holy Ghost revival.
Amen.
Pray until our eyes become open so that we can understand that we, you know, we really need to what? Submit a whole lot more. We need to obey God a whole lot more fervently. All right, his fervency in prayer and in his compassion for Israel. We don't have time for that, but we do know that Moses, he fell down before the Lord many, many, many times. And all of the different instances in which he almost gave in, gave up. I mean, some instances, some of his notable prayers, we can see in verse point two, D under D. When Israel had sinned and they had made a golden calf, and Moses came down from the mount, he was so angry until he broke the commandments, right? Those tablets, right, that the commandments were written on. And Moses really had to pray to get a hold of his emotions. And verse 16, and I looked, and behold, ye had sinned against the Lord your God, and made molten calf. Ye had turned aside quickly out of the way which the Lord had commanded you. And I took the two tables and cast them out of my two hands and break them before your eyes. And I fell down before the Lord. Okay, that's the point. And I fell down before the Lord as at the first 40 days and 40 nights. I did neither eat bread nor drink water because of all of your sins, which ye have sinned in doing wickedly in the sight of the Lord to provoke him to anger. For I was afraid of the anger and hot displeasure wherewith the Lord was wroth with against you to destroy you, but the Lord hearkened unto me at that time also. The Lord was very angry with Aaron to have destroyed him, and I prayed for Aaron also the same time. So Moses was a man that God always responded to. Because he was always broken, he prayed out of his heart, and he always pleaded on the behalf of Israel. Amen. And he always made the fact that God was plenteous in mercy, he always, amen, brought that to God's attention. Lord, we messed up. Israel has really done wickedly in your sight, but Lord, you are our God of mercy. His fervency and persistence in prayer is deeply felt. And this was the time that God, he had to pray. This Moses returned to the Lord. This is verse 31 under number 3. All this people have sinned a great sin and have made them gods of gold. Yet now that thou wilt forgive their sin, and if not, blot me, I pray thee, out of that book which thou hast what? Written. The Lord said unto Moses, whosoever has sinned against me, him will I blot out of my book. Note again in Numbers 14 and 11, when this time, this is a whole lot of stuff here, but it's good. After God had threatened to smite Israel with a pestilence and disturb them and make Moses a mightier nation than they, their uncontrollable outbursts of unbelief resulting from the report of the 10 spies caused a great commotion and sparked an idea to stone Joshua and Caleb, who brought back the good report. Again, Moses intervened and pleaded with the Lord to pardon their iniquity and spare the nation for his name's sake. Amen. Did God do it? Verse 19, pardon thy beseech thee the iniquity of thy people according to the greatness of thy mercy, as thou hast forgiven this people from Egypt even unto them. And the Lord said, I have pardoned according to thy word. Then Miriam, when she spoke against Moses, Moses cried unto the Lord, saying, heal her now, O God. He didn't cry, Lord. Lord, Lord, take care of this woman. Let her go down just like those other folk that went down in the, fell out in hell, I mean, that went down in an earthquake. She had already received her punishment, Sister Hill. She had already become what? Leprous, white as snow. And Moses cried unto the Lord, said, heal her now. Did she get healed? Yes, her flesh returned. Moses was a powerful intercessor. Then there's the case of Korah, Dathan, and Abiram. And it was 250 of them, famous men, renowned in the congregation. They spoke against Moses, and when Moses had heard it, he fell on his face before God, challenging their right to bring accusation against him, commanded them to appear before him the next day by refusing to appear before him. By refusing to appear before him, as he had commanded, the three leaders and their followers were swallowed up by the earth. Number 16, that scripture is wrong, should be 16:11. When all the congregation above murmured against Moses and Aaron and accused them of killing the Lord's people, the evil leaders and followers, Moses and Aaron, fell on their faces. God became very angry at the murmurers among the congregation and began to strike them and consume them. Suddenly with a plague, Moses intervened and commanded Aaron to make an atonement for the people. And he, which was Aaron, stood between the dead and the living, and the plague was stayed, not before 14,700, one of those zeros need to be taken off, additional people perish. All right, so you can see that Moses was a man of what? Prayer. Everybody said Moses was a man of prayer. All right, so I don't know whether y'all worked this hard or not. If y'all did, you should have gotten a whole lot out of it. Moses suffered in glory, and that's the last part. We don't have time to get into all of that. But I like some of the points we made here. Verse 3, Moses was with the Lord for prolonged and difficult
periods on Mount Sinai, I regret that, receiving the law and statutes, he spent at least 2 40-day periods alone with the Lord, both 40-day periods he made and ate my drink. Now, verse 4, Moses complained to God how many times? He was rebuked and chastened by God, and by one act of disobedience, he was what? Not permitted to enter into the promised land. This act of irreverence for God and disrespect to the people of Israel was very costly and prevented Moses from receiving his cherished dream. All right, these are the things that Moses accomplished, and these were the things that he's noted for experiencing. He was Israel's deliverer, lawgiver, ruler, and greatest prophet. I want y'all to read 5b, everybody. Moses was what? Called or what? He talked to God, what? Face to face, as a man speaking. He was one of the two who appeared and talked with Jesus. Okay, was that an honor? All right, he was the meekest man, which were among the what? And was highly respected and revered by who? People also of all generations speak of Moses as a great what? He was a man of fearless faith who held steadfast to his call and purpose by seeing him or beholding him who was what? Invisible. He was permitted to see a limited view of God's glory after praying for God to show him his way and his glory. He's the one that saw a limited view of God's glory. He and his writings were spoken of and referred to many times by the prophets, kings, Jesus, the apostles, and so forth. He was regarded as the most commanding and dominant figure of the Old Testament and the mediator of the Old Covenant. Moses, a type of Christ, knew the ways of God, manifested the glory of God. God's nature and his ways were revealed to Israel and to the nations through Moses' faithfulness and obedience. Moses knew the ways of God because he stayed in the Lord's presence, talked to God face to face, as a man speaketh unto his friend, and worked together with God to bring Israel out of bondage to Canaan. Moses learned the ways of God through his obedience, submission, suffering, and victory. All right, for y'all that did study this, you see what you missed. And on page 30, 24, 25, I want you to respond to those three questions on page 24, page 25, and 26. We want you to respond to those five questions. All right, so next week, who would like to help me with this? These exercises for review. We went through the lesson, and all we want to do is to discuss the questions next week. And I don't necessarily have to have a part in that. So who would like to help me with this? Just raise your hand. Who would like to help me with this next week? Oh, Pastor might be tired next week. All right. Anybody? Nobody want to mess with it. All right, let's move on. All right. All right, so we're going to pray that Moses 17 times he was spoken of as what? A servant of the Lord. So we're going to see how many servants of the Lord we're going to have out of all this teaching. If we go through all of this and don't do no better, oh Lord, have mercy on us. All right, so these lessons are designed to teach you that whatever it took for these people that were called servants and followers of Christ, people that holy, W-H-O-L-L-Y, holy follow the Lord. Caleb and Joshua was one of the only two out of the original bunch. I understand, except for maybe a few priests or whatever. They were the only one that made it to the promised land. So what land are we trying to make? What land are we? Are we going to try to make to the same promised land? All right. But we're trying to make it what? Make it to heaven. All right. How many believe that to make it to heaven, you're going to have to wholly follow the Lord? Now, how many understand what holy, W-H-O-L-L-Y? You know, I'm not talking about H-O-L-E-Y. You know, it's
some people's holiness got so many holes in it. And all of it has leaked out. All right, but the scripture says we're going to have to what? Holy. Everybody say holy.
Holy.
Amen. And when we try to get you to praise the Lord and you don't praise Him, is that holy? Then at least we ought to be able to have a decent prayer meeting. Is that right?
Amen.
It starts in prayer. Amen. So I'm looking for an outburst, even in worship, within this month. And we're going to call a time, season, where we're going to make up our minds that we're going to holy, W-H-O-L-L-Y, holy, what? Follow the Lord. Can you see a distinct difference between the quality of commitment that Moses had and the quality of leaders today? Can you see a distinct difference? How many leaders today would find in two chapters, 17 times, that Moses did everything the Lord told him to do? Amen. Now, sometimes we do 1 out of 20. 1 out of 10, you know, sometimes we think that we've done what? A big thing. Amen. But one thing the Lord has spoken to me is that we need to start noticing the Word of God a lot closer. You know, there's no excuse for coming to a Bible study and not making any effort, even when you have a book. Amen. Some don't even have a book. I know some don't even have the book.
Make any effort to do what?
Have no effort to even read anything. Yeah. Work out anything.
And after you read and work it out, then the purpose of doing that is so that you make the changes that you need to.
Right, to make the changes that you need to. It all won't come through instructions. The Word of God is where it starts. Amen. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
Everybody say amen.
Amen.
How many are going to do better?
Amen.
How many are going to start worshiping the Lord with all your heart?
Amen.
Let's hear some half amens. All right. All right. Brother Wendell blessed me a couple Sundays ago. He said that Sunday we had that breakthrough, and more people was just, you know, I mean, it was just crying. And I noticed that Sister Hill is doing that. Well, I'm just kidding. Now, Sunday, she was weeping and crying. I mean, she's been doing it a lot. I just said, I wonder, is that because she's outreading me? She's beating me to read the Bible. I started taking some dope today. I said, every day I see her for hours and hours reading the Bible, and now she's weeping and crying and broken. I say, amen. I mean, amen. She keep on that, she'd be out skipping me. Well, that's a lesson. Let's get back to the Word. Everybody say, let's get back to the Word. Amen. So that's all I have tonight. I hope that. All right, we didn't get to the questions, but we can talk about the questions and not know the meat of it, what's behind it. And we just be what? Beating in the air. Sometimes what we do. We want to discuss all these questions, but we haven't read none of that material, so we don't. Amen. We don't, you know, hit it quite right. I'm sure glad to see you tonight. What the use of you, man? You thought I was talking about Brother Wendell. I'm glad to see you too. But he blessed me that Sunday. Boy, he said that man, the anointing was so high. See, people love that. We get that breakthrough, that brokenness, and people get genuine. That real Spirit of God begins to work through us. Amen. I don't think that we ought to try to cut it off, try to hush it up. We ought to try to promote it. Amen. Because that blesses people. The humble shall hear thereof and be what? Glad. Amen. The humble shall hear thereof. And... All right. Let's say praise the Lord.
Praise the
Lord. All right. I'm going to put Sister Hill in charge next week. Trying to wiggle out already. All right, something that needs to be ready. All right, the way you do it with the Denise, because, amen, I might be tired this week. I don't know what's there, because I'm tired. That's what I'll say. Praise the Lord. Glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All right, let's lift up our hearts tonight. See, this was the old school. I would have them to stay for 30 minutes and pray. So I really laugh. Yeah, this was the old school. But if I kept out here 30 minutes, amen. The Jesus said, the joy of the Lord is my what? Strength. Amen. So this is the new school. So we have to govern ourselves accordingly. All right. Father, tonight as we leave this place, we leave knowing that you who have begun the good work within us, you shall continue to perform it. We give you praise and the glory now. In Jesus' name, everybody just say, in Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name,
everybody say together, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. The reason